Good morning and welcome to spring break at Woodmont. Glad you all could make it. And we especially welcome our visitors that are here for the first time and welcome Joe Bragg and his family that are here. He's playing the guitar for us this morning, and I understand you all are next door neighbors to Chris and Dorothy Stewart.
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. Right. Yep.
Glad he's doing better. He is.
He is.
Says he's without pain. That's good. You know, we used to have that connection form in your bulletin that you would sign up and put your prayer requests on, and they changed the form, and it's no longer in your bulletin because then everybody would open their bulletin and the papers would drop out. So it's in the back of the pew before you. There's a card in there, and it's for first-time visitors to let us know if you want any information from the church or that you're here and you can sign up for things. It's for members. If you have an address change or an email change or phone number change. But for all of us, it's also a prayer request card. And if you know of people that need prayer or you want prayer, ask for prayers. There'll be people praying all during the week. So it's an important card. And since they put them in the pews, we've noticed there hadn't been as many prayer requests. So I want to make sure we understand that there's still the opportunity for your prayer requests. It's just in a different way there, a different form. 2 weeks from today, believe it or not, is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week. I can't believe it. It'll be here already, but it's early this year. But that also means that we are halfway through the Lenten season. So if you had any aspirations of strengthening your spiritual life, I hope you're working well on that. If not, I want to remind you it's halfway through. You better get going. And if you want it to make a difference in your life as Lent is supposed to be doing. We will have our Wednesday night dinners and classes. Those four classes are all intended to strengthen your spiritual life. And if you haven't been yet, you can come the next two Wednesday nights, enjoy good food, good fellowship, and decide which one of the classes you'd like to attend. And it'll be worth your time, I guarantee you. The other thing I want to say is that we have, as you know, 31 members of our church that are in Guatemala. They have arrived down there safely. Clay let me know. And today they're leaving Guatemala City and going to where the families live, where we have been building the houses. It's a four-hour bus trip they'll be on today. But this is the first time that we've done it as a family trip. And so most of those 31 are different families that have gone, parents with their children. So I invite you to pray for them all during this week for their safety and security, and secondly, that they will all have a wonderful, life-changing experience, especially for the children that are on that trip. But we've come here now to worship God. Let us prepare our hearts to do that.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. I love that old cross, the dearest and best the world of lost sinners I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be. shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, for his glory forever I'll share. And I'll cherish the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown, and exchange it someday for a crown.
Amen. Thank you, Jay. Good morning. If you would please stand with me as we say our call to worship this morning. It's found on page 760 of your hymnals. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? The Lord will not let your foot be moved. The Lord who keeps you will not slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. Please join me in singing our hymn of praise, number 56. Heavenly Father, let us take just a moment to take a breath. Breathe in this time as we seek you today. Oh Lord, let us find a stillness that only you provide. Let us be rooted in you. Let us be rooted in your words. Let us be rooted in the music and the prayers. Let them all ground us in faith and hope as we begin a new week. Let us always seek to know you better. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Our scripture this morning is from Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30, the parable of weeds among the wheat. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seeds in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Thanks be to the word.
Thank you.
It was an idyllic, spring-like Valentine's Day. People were strolling about in the sunshine on a brisk morning. Many of them were pushing baby strollers. There was a spirit of celebration in the air in this upbeat and diverse crowd. Everything seemed so right with the world in this beautiful setting. People were laughing, smiling, some were singing. Children of various ages and shapes and sizes and colors were tossing footballs on the grass. Most of them were wearing jerseys with the numbers 15 or 87. 15 for the quarterback, Patrick Mahomes, 87 for the tight end, Travis Kelce. And that's because they had all come, almost a million of them, to celebrate the Kansas City Chiefs' victory in the Super Bowl. There were many so-called Swifties in the crowd as little girls sat on their father's shoulders trying to see if they could get a glimpse of Taylor Swift. They didn't know she was already back in Australia. The Kansas City Chiefs had just left the stage when all of a sudden, pop, 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 the sound of gunshots rang out. As one local newspaper described it, the day and even this golden time in Kansas City was shattered by an all too familiar American tragedy that descended upon them. The never-ending cycle of shots fired by lunatics and mass casualties and terrified throngs scrambling for safety and the chilling sound of endless sirens. At least one person was killed, 21 others were shot, including 9 children, ages 6 to 15. And once again, it became another version of our 21st century day that the music died. But shocking as it was, the evil and the sadness of this day isn't really considered a surprise in our country anymore. It seems to be the price that we pay to live in America today. And to make matters worse, there doesn't seem to be anything that can be done about it or willing to do about it. This experience of unbridled joy and deep mourning is but another expression of what I think Jesus was describing in our scripture lesson this morning about the parable of the wheat and the tares. Now, Jesus didn't just make up this story about some mysterious enemy sowing weeds in another man's wheat field just so he could preach a sermon on the Last Judgment, although that's certainly an important part of the message here. But Jesus is also pointing out how we have and always will have both the good and the bad together, and both good and bad people in side by side in this world. Good and evil, joy and sorrow, tears and laughter, they're all a part of the experience of life. And in fact, I would say that it's the good times that make us realize the bad things. And it's the bad things that make us really appreciate the good things. So why did Jesus tell this parable? Was it because one of his disciples raised his hand and said, "Master, why do bad things happen to good people?" Was it because they saw, in spite of all the good that Jesus was doing, so much bad that continued to exist in the world? Was it because they were growing uneasy with the different kinds of people who were mixing into the crowd around Jesus? Sinners, social outcasts, prostitutes, embezzlers, even scribes and Pharisees. Some of the disciples obviously wanted to do some weeding out, separating the tares from the good wheat, purging the crowds of those that they didn't think deserved to be around Jesus. You know, ever since I was a young preacher, I have heard the criticism that the church is full of hypocrites. And when I was younger, I used to get very defensive about that and point out that there may be people in the church that we can't fully live up to what our goals are, but it means we're trying. Hypocrites are those that don't even try, that profess one thing but do something else. But people in the church who are admitting they need to grow and become more like the Lord wants them, they're not hypocrites. They're sinners seeking salvation. But then when I read this parable of Jesus about the tares and the wheat, I might take a different approach to that criticism and say, you're right, there are some hypocrites in the church because the good and the bad are always mixed together. But who are the hypocrites? And who can tell? Some of those that you think might be hypocrites really prove not to be. And some of those that you would never think are hypocrites in the long run prove to be just that. But what Jesus is saying in this parable is that we cannot tell the difference and we will not know for sure until the harvest comes, which means the day of judgment. Should the doors of the church be open to just anybody and everybody, allowing anyone to be a part of the church who wants to be? Some churches, some Christians, have said no. They don't believe that. During the years I've been in the ministry, I've seen different groups of people have been turned away from churches. Back in the 60s, it began with divorced peoples, and then it began with black people, and then it began with gay people, and then rapists, murderers, addicts, embezzlers, a whole list that goes on that people want to purge and not allow to be a part of the church. They would vote them out, or they wouldn't let them in the first place. In other words, they want to do what Jesus said not to do and try and pull out the weeds in the midst of the good wheat. But other people like me would say, yes, let them be a part of the church. All who believe in Jesus Christ and who are trying to straighten out their lives and do better should be welcomed in the church. And none of us has the right to judge who is sincere and who is not. I say that all should be allowed to be part of the church for at least two reasons. Number one, because there's no such thing as a perfect person. As Paul said, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if we didn't allow sinners into the church, there wouldn't be anybody here. But secondly, because the church is a hospital for sinners, not a refuge for saints. Even Jesus said, it's the sick who have need of the doctor, not the well. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. A number of years ago, one of my church members came up to me and said, you know, last Sunday I worshiped at this prominent church in the city and said, I couldn't believe there were three men standing at the front door greeting everybody who came to worship, and all three of those men had served prison terms. Were they hypocrites? Or were they acknowledged sinners seeking to be rehabilitated? Who knows except God? Some would be shocked. This person was shocked who told me about it. Others like me would think, boy, that's wonderful. What better place for them to be, to learn more and to grow in life? And like Jesus said, judgment will only come at harvest time. The parable of the wheat and the tares is a teaching about the last judgment. But its message is really threefold, at least. Number one, it's a warning to us not to try and judge other people. Number two, It is a warning that someday the judgment will come, but it will be God's judgment, not our judgment. And number three, and the point that I'm really wanting to lift up today and focus on, is that in the meantime, between now and the judgment day, as we call it, the good and the bad will continue to exist side by side in our world. Now, to better understand this parable, I might point out that in Jesus' time, there was a certain weed that was called bearded darnel, or what we refer to as the tares in this parable. It was a poisonous plant, and it caused dizziness if you ate it. But what made the weed a particularly bad problem was that it was impossible to distinguish the bearded darnel from the true wheat in the early stages of growth. When the wheat and the tares grew together in the field, their roots also became so intertwined that if you tried to pull either one up, you were going to also affect and probably damage the other. The only safe way to separate the two was to wait until harvest time. For when both were fully grown, the wheat was so much taller than the bearded darnel, the weeds. Now, Jesus didn't just make up this story so he could teach a lesson about the last judgment, although, like I said, it does talk about the last judgment. But this was a common thing that happened back then among people that had a grudge against somebody else. It was a typical act that if you had a problem with your neighbor, you're mad at your neighbor, you go sow weeds, tares, bearded darnel into his wheat fields and ruin his crop. A few verses later, beginning with verse 37, Jesus gives us an interpretation of this parable. He says, "The Son of Man," meaning Jesus, "sows the good seed. His field is the whole world. The good seed is the children of the kingdom. The tares are the children who belong to Satan, the wicked one. The enemy who sows the tares is the devil. The harvest time is the end of the world. The reapers are God's angels." And so it is a parable about the last judgment, an apocalyptic vision of the end of time and the coming day of judgment. But to me, like I said, the real value of this scripture for us living today in the 21st century has to do with the problem of evil that we're always struggling with. The stubborn fact that sin exists, where did it come from? We can't answer that question. How do we have so much evil, bad things that happen in the good world that God created? How do we understand and accept the tragic events that happen all the time? The parable does not explain the origin of evil. It simply points out the fact that evil exists, that both good and bad exist together. And that's the point that I'm really wanting you to see this morning, that the good and the bad exist side by side. Nothing is perfect. Everything in this world has its good and bad aspects. Think of all the different categories of life, and this applies. Take marriage and family life, for example. There's no greater joy than a good marriage and a healthy family life. But while marriages may be made in heaven, they're lived out here on earth. There's no greater joy than raising children if it's done right. But still, every parent can tell you there's going to be a lot of trials and tribulations, if not pain and suffering, along the way. Marriage and family life under constant tension and stress and even attack in our world today, the good and the bad exist together. Therefore, it's important that we learn how to deal with it in the right way. that we enjoy the good and learn how to navigate through the bad, knowing that the day of reaping will come. So think about other areas of life and if this principle applies to those areas, good and bad, joys and difficulties. Think of, for example, the miracles of modern medicine, which absolutely amaze me how some of these drugs today can literally save people's lives, yet at the same time, they can have some pretty difficult side effects that you might go through. The same thing is true with our work, with our jobs. I doubt if anybody enjoys his work any more than I enjoy mine, but to be honest, I have to say, there are some times when it can seem like sheer drudgery and irritation. That's why some people are constantly changing jobs, just like other people are constantly changing marriage partners, thinking that they're going to find the perfect situation. But how much happier we'd be if we would just listen to what Jesus says in this parable, that the good and the bad are always going to be there together, and just learn to accept it and then to make the most of it. How many times have I had people say to me, man, I got this next door neighbor who is absolutely wonderful, but on the other side, I got another one that isn't so wonderful. Or what about growing older? Those of us that are doing that can tell you it's got both the good and the bad. The aches and the pains and the illnesses are a part of it, but hey, it beats the alternative. And as we grow older, there are a lot of wonderful things that we experience that we can't experience until we get older. The joy of watching our children and our grandchildren grow up and get married and have families. Enjoying lifelong friendships that last 30, 40, 50 years. Believe me, those are the most wonderful friendships you can have in this world. Gaining wisdom. Wisdom only comes by living longer. The longer you live, the more wisdom you gain. Discovering what's really important in life as we grow older. And believe me, it's not the same thing that we thought was most important when we were much younger. No, life will never be trouble-free, but the secret of life is to realize this and then learn how to live with the imperfections. As one wise sage put it, the beginning of wisdom is the acceptance of imperfection. So as Christians, how do we cope with the evils of life? Jesus said not to try and get rid of the tares, for you might damage the wheat as well. But leave the tares with the wheat until harvest time and learn to live with it. Focus your attention on the wheat, on what is good. Build it up. And on the day of harvest, the tares will be destroyed. So our approach to life with its mixed joys and sorrows, tears and laughter, good and bad, whatever you want to call it, our approach should be a positive one rather than a negative one. Don't try to get rid of all the tares. Don't try to judge and hunt out all the hypocrites. But spend your time preaching a positive gospel and living a positive life. And then leave the rest up to God. The only way to truly destroy evil is to overcome it with good. Amen.
Watch and pray, watch and pray.
We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. I wonder what goes through your mind when you hear this title, the hymn of invitation. It is an invitation. It's an invitation on the part of Jesus to come and follow me. And we sing it every Sunday because in our church, the only requirement we have for people to be a part of the community of faith here at Woodmont is one, that they believe in Christ, and two, they want to be a part of the church here. Nothing else, no other hoops you have to jump through. But it's also an invitation to those who are already a part of the church to continue working at following Jesus. We need to grow, you know. When you join the church, that's just the beginning. That's not the end. And kind of like Clay says when we have introduction to Woodmont, he says, we want to make it easy for you to become a part of the church, but then we really want to challenge you to live up to what it means to be a follower of Jesus or a disciple of Christ. So as we sing the hymn this morning, we invite anyone that would like to become a part of the church. You can do it now. You come down front. Let me know that's your intention. There's a blue card in the back of the pews. You can fill it out. Bring it down front, or you can hand it to Clay on any given Sunday, or you can give it to us in the introduction to Woodmont class we have about every month. But we want to make it easy for you to become a part of the church. And for the rest of us who are already a part, it's a time to ask ourselves, especially during this Lenten season, how well am I living up to the commitment I made when I first became a part of Christ's church? Before we sing the hymn, let's reaffirm what it is that we believe in. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and my personal Lord and Savior. And what is the mission of Woodmont? Growing disciples of Christ by seeking God, sharing love, and serving others. So let us stand as we sing this great hymn.
In addition to the names listed in your bulletin, please lift up Wilbur Sensing. He was admitted to the hospital yesterday and hopes to be going home soon. And as Roy mentioned, keep in your prayers all of our Guatemala travelers this week and all of our families who are traveling for spring break. Would you join me now in prayer? Dear Lord, your parables and your words can fuel our spirits and hopefully will shape our actions. our nourishment to live the Christian life through all of our passages as we grow and mature comes from you. You gave us Jesus, who showed us how to love and serve and obey. But we get bogged down when life's journeys present challenges. Admittedly, we are creatures of convenience and sometimes forget that the hard, steep path to you is to be practiced by giving and taking in a world that does not revolve around us. Too easily, we may do what's wrong instead of what is right. We thank you for the freedom we have to choose our thoughts as we use them daily, shaping who we are. Thank you for the gift of your love and forgiveness, and for hearing our cries for help and then comforting us. Thank you, Lord, for the grace that blesses us in an unexpected kindness, a serendipitous experience, a forgiven error, and the assurance that we are loved and secure with you. Though we may be tempted to give in to negativity, please don't give up on us. Remind us to choose to be positive, to serve others, to take courage in facing adversity, and trusting and following and obeying you. Lord, we pray for your help shaping us to be our very best selves and cleaning out the weeds in our own lives as we step out in hope and faith. There are many, many people and situations in our hearts and on our minds, some we know well and others of which we are just aware. A big prayer request is for unity among the people in this world. Another is for all those who find themselves in the storms of their lives. Please breathe new life into their circumstances. As believers across our world, Lord, we pray that we share love more freely, give more generously, and forgive more easily in renewing our commitment to follow Jesus as we now pray together in his name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When I look at the title of Roy's sermon this morning, The Good and the Bad, I think of three things. I think that in God, we are rooted and in the good and in the bad. We are rooted with Jesus in the good and in the bad. And we are rooted in this community in the good and in the bad. And I don't know about you all, and it is a blessing to have a community like Woodmont when we are in the good, when it's happy and joyful. But it is even more amazing to have a community like Woodmont when we are in the bad and when we are in the trenches and when we need each other. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the gifts that we receive today. May we always use them to honor and glorify your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
amen to that. That was powerful. Thank you, Jeff and Anita Sheridan. You know, our scripture this morning, the parable of the wheat and the tares, reminds us again that nobody ever promised us a life that would be easy, because life is a struggle. And sometimes the struggle gets harder than at other times. It's a struggle between the good and the bad. But when we come to worship each Sunday, particularly when we gather around the table of the Lord's Supper, we are reminded of Jesus' promise that I will be with you always. I will be there to help you in the struggle. It's not going to mean you won't struggle, but he will help you deal with it and get through it. Because we are reminded that when life makes us grow weary, the Lord gives us strength. When we become confused about what we might do, the Lord gives us wisdom. When our lives get in turmoil, that easily happens in the world today, the Lord gives us peace. When we sorrow the loss of loved ones, the Lord gives us comfort. When we are hurting, the Lord gives us healing. And when we get discouraged, the Lord gives us hope, always hope. So I hope that all of these things will be yours, that you will experience them in your life at all times, and that you'll renew the source of that experience as we come now to the table and commune with our Lord. Every time we come to this table, we want to remember the words of our Lord when he instituted this sacrament by giving thanks and blessing and breaking the bread and offering it to his first disciples as he offers it to us today, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And with the cup, Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, renew the covenant as often as you drink from it in remembrance of me." Let us pray with our elders.
Heavenly Father, help us to focus on the reason we take communion. Jesus was a perfect sacrificial lamb. He was crucified and died. His death gave us forgiveness of our sins. Please bless this bread, which represents Christ's broken body. As we partake of the bread, let it spiritually nourish our hearts, minds, and bodies, and draw us into a deeper relationship with you.
Loving God, wherever we happen to be this morning, in the light and joy of your presence, or in the long shadows of your seeming absence or silence, we drink from this cup in remembrance of your Son, Jesus Christ. We seek your strength. We ask that you fill us with your faith. We praise you for our blessings. During this Lenten season, we invite you into our hearts. We recommit our lives to you. Forgive us and restore us. Nothing can separate us from your love. Amen.
remember, we're halfway through Lent, and you've still got 2 weeks left to get ready for Holy Week. And we'll have our Wednesday night dinners and classes offered for the next 2 weeks. And whether you've been yet or not, don't miss the last two. And also, I encourage you to pray for our families that are down in Guatemala for their safe trip experience and a wonderful life-changing experience. Let us prepare for our sending forth. Go forth now and live, leaving your worries, your troubles, your fears behind, taking in their place faith and hope and love, for these are the gifts of Christ to you. Amen.